We're here today with Congressman Joseph DioGuardi, representative from the 20th Congressional District of New York in Westchester County. Welcome to Italics, Congressman DioGuardi.
Nice to be here, Joe.
Thank you. I understand that you began your career as a certified public accountant with the firm of Arthur Anderson & Company, and that you spent 22 years with that firm before you decided to make the transition from CPA to congressman. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, it wasn't an easy transition, as you might imagine. But frankly, it's an experience that I'm hoping others will follow, because I think government today needs to have more business-like thinking and people with business backgrounds. And in the back of my mind, I thought I would elect early retirement in my 50s and do something like this, but I hadn't decided it would be Congress. But in 1982, the suggestion was made by a group of businessmen that I should think about running for Congress. And by the time 1984 came around, the seed was planted. What most people said could not be done, coming right out of business, not having had either a legal background or a political background, I managed to win in a very difficult race.
Congressman DioGuardi, you're an Italian-American. Can you tell us something about how your background helped shape your values?
Well, my father came from Italy in 1929 as a very poor boy from Naples. They were having a depression in Italy at the time, and I guess Dad didn't realize that when he came here, we were having a depression here. So he couldn't get a job for a couple of years. He was 15. You talk about the story of America. It's not just my story. You can multiply this, I guess, millions of times by many ethnic groups, certainly Italian Americans, because that's the experience I was raised with in the Bronx here before we moved to Westchester County in 1957. But Dad had to work for everything he has. He didn't have an education. He only went
to
the fourth grade.
As well. You might say I'm coming home. I was raised in the Bronx. This is where I was born and raised. Dad had a grocery store on Tremont Avenue and Crotona Avenue. I went to St. Martin of Tours Grammar School and Fordham Prep. And we moved to Westchester County when my dad realized that they opened up the Major Deegan in 1957 and he could get to the farmer's market by the Yankee Stadium without spending too much time. And that's what determined where we would live. I think my experience is very much like your experience, and I'd like to talk about that as well. I should begin by saying buongiorno, all right?
I went to St. Martin of Tours here in the Bronx, and then Fordham Prep. I used to have to go to the store after school. I did my studying on pear boxes and apple boxes in the back of the store in between delivering orders. So you might say I was raised with a European experience. We like to work. That's the work ethic. You know, Italians, I always said I don't meet many lazy Italians. Everybody wants to get a job, get something done. And that's good for America.
Congressman DioGuardi, in a book which you recently co-authored with 9 other congresspersons entitled The House of Ill Repute, a book which reportedly is an indictment of the House of Representatives, you say that Congress has, I quote, a credit card mentality. What do you mean by that?
I thought it would be appropriate for me to use one of the chapters to unbundle the fiscal irresponsibility, the lack of public accountability that I've witnessed since I have been in Washington in 3 and now 4 years. So I couldn't think of a better topic to write on than this credit card mentality that we have in Congress today, because the public, as far as I'm concerned, is getting a raw deal. We're spending a lot of money.
Here's my commercial. You know, some people need that American Express Gold card and its $10,000 limit to feel powerful. Others need that Platinum card with its $100,000 limit to feel really powerful. I've got a card that puts those two to shame. My congressional voting card. My friends, take a good hard look at this card. This is the most expensive credit card in the world. This card has no limit. Now, when you or your spouse gets a call from American Express, Diners, MasterCharge, Visa, or whatever, and you've reached your $2,000 limit or your $5,000 limit, you know that economic reality has arrived. You sit down with the family, you look at your standard of living, you might even defer a vacation. Not with this card. Last year we reached $2 trillion, the national debt. What do? We just kept raising the ceiling, the limit, the debt ceiling. We say, pass it on to the kids, let them pay for it. We've got a credit card mentality in this country, and we've got to take this card away from those legislators, Democrat or Republican, that are using it irresponsibly.
Wouldn't all these offices just create a bigger federal bureaucracy and ultimately cost the taxpayers even more money?
That question comes up all the time. Frankly, there is so much duplication and overlap going on right now, that there's a need to now coordinate in one place the financial management responsibilities for this massive financial entity called the United States of America. We literally spent last year $1 trillion, but guess what, Joe? That's what was on the books. You can't believe what we're spending that's off the books. Mm. The guarantees, the contingencies, the accounts payable, the accrued pensions that are nowhere to be found because of that Mickey Mouse cash basis system I'm telling you about. If we were to use the right system, it's called generally accepted accounting principles, it's imposed on any public corporation, you might find out that the national debt is not 2.4 trillion. Hold on to your seat. It's $6 trillion as of now. Because when you see that 2.4 trillion, all that is the cash we spent. It doesn't tell you what we owe in Social Security for those people that have to retire that already paid in, because we've used that cash already. We are playing the biggest shell game in the world right now. And that's why I had to write the book, A House of Ill Repute. Not because I feel that Congress is a bad place. It's a beautiful place. I'm honored to be there. But it hurts me to see the public so cynical about Congress when they see the shell game going on and money being spent, many people just doing it because they want to get reelected every 2 years. And I felt I had to shock the American public into becoming more involved.
Well, you certainly have a job ahead of you, I'm sure, but under your capable hands, we'll probably be very successful.
Thank you.
I want to thank you very much for sharing your views today with us here on Italics.